ended up sliding. The motorcycle ended up sliding, which is how people knew that I ended up wiping out, because then everyone ran out from an adjacent building to offer me aid.
Hey everyone, my name is Nakaras. I am the co-founder of Brummell. I'm thrilled to announce that this is the first episode of what we hope will become a series of video podcasts featuring different motorcycle riders and owners of the Brummell Motorcycle Blazer. Throughout the series, they'll share their experiences and stories about the passion for riding, their daily journeys as motorcyclists, and situations that they encounter during their commutes. To kick off this series, we have a very special guest today. I'm really happy to speak with him. Unfortunately, he got recently into a really serious motorcycle accident while commuting to work. So he's here today to share his experience of how the whole thing went, understand about the entire story and the situation. So it will be a really interesting discussion. So please welcome László Szabó, known as Laz. Did I pronounce that well?
Yep, you got it.
Yeah, that's great. Laz, thank you very much for taking the time to join our video interview series. First of all, let me express our happiness in seeing you today fully recovered from the accident, because that's the most important thing. So, Laz, could you tell us a bit about yourself? I mean, where are you from and what do you do for work?
Sure, happy to. And good to meet you face to face. I'm an attorney who spent the last about 20 years both commuting and as well as working in higher education. So predominantly with universities and colleges in America. And as much as I can, I try to commute on a motorcycle. For me, that means a mix of highways and smaller roads. And then on campuses, if I can, going from meeting to meeting on the bike, just because it's usually more efficient. And it's actually through that I learned about your product, because I didn't want to show up to these meetings with, you know, faculty or deans looking like Mad Max from from Thunderdome.
Curious to learn more about it, but really interested in asking you, like, what do you usually ride? Like, what's your daily rider?
Yeah, so I originally got into riding by riding off-road, not like heavy-duty enduro motorcycles, but my first bike was a Honda CRF250L. So it was, you know, predominantly a dual sport, I guess. And then I got into riding on track just by going to motorcycle education classes that happened on track. And right now I have three Triumphs. I have a Thruxton 1200 that I enjoy a lot. It's got a great sound. My commuter bike, which is way overpowered but is fun, is a Speed Triple 1200 RS. And then for the track, I have a 1200 double R, which is track dedicated only.
That's a pretty...
So my accident actually happened on the 1200 RS.
Bad to hear that, though. It's a really pretty collection of Triumph bikes out there. So it's good range of different types. And I can see you're a big Triumph fan.
Yeah, I used to love Hondas, and just there's something about, well, one, modern Triumphs to me are reliable. I enjoy riding the bikes, not as much working on them, although I enjoy working on them, but I don't want to, you know, maintain them granularly all the time. And there is something about the just the sound of a nice Triumph.
Oh, for sure. They have that special sound, for sure. And also the refinement of the bikes, it's just another level. Mm-hmm. So, yeah,
absolutely.
Love them as well. How often do you actually, I mean, you mentioned you pretty much ride, you have quite a, you know, a broad experience in different types of riding, from track to just street riding to off-road. So how often do you actually commute with your motorcycle, to work or to any other events, and what does your journey really look like on a daily basis? And how it, I'm more curious to understand how it looked like before versus now, so just we can compare that.
Yeah, sure. So my so like I said, I commute on the 1200 RS. Before then it was actually a Honda Africa Twin. My commute generally across the past several years of commuting has been a mixture of sort of two lane roads from my house to then, inescapably, because I'm around the Philadelphia region, as urban as the Philadelphia city area to four lane highways, whether it's during rush hour or outside of it, to then coming on campus. So it's a fairly varied, but I would say pretty urban commuting type of an experience. The off-roading is really just something that I try to do to keep up some skills, and because it's sometimes fun. In terms of how often I do this, and this is something I'm reevaluating after the accident, because the cause of the accident was black ice. But I have a lot of heated gear, and so I've been, other than if it's truly a horrible rain, inches and inches of rain, or there's antifreeze treatment on the road, just because that's so corrosive, I don't want that on the motorcycle, or if it's snowing or ice or sleeting, I have commuted. So if it's 20 Fahrenheit out, again, I have heated gloves, I have the little sort of winter, handlebar muff that I'll put on the Triumph, which makes it look silly but keeps my hand warm. I have a heated jacket, so I'm really comfortable riding year round, so long as the weather is not something that would create some sort of an issue. So in a year, just commuting on a motorcycle, I probably average, because I live close to work, 9 to 10,000 miles. And just that's just the commuting back and forth, because I can ride year round.
Wow. So it's so almost every single day.
Yeah, usually 4 days a week, I would say, on average. I'm in the office, and when I am, then I end up commuting.
Yeah. All right. Interesting to hear that. So about the commuting part, so what was your regular daily setup when it comes to gear? What would you usually wear? Are you mostly overalls type of guy, or do you do jacket and pants? And how was the whole, walk me through the journey. How would you dress up for work, basically? So what would you wear?
Yeah, sure. So that's a great question. Because I have a job that usually requires me to wear a suit or a sports jacket, what I've done actually before I got your product was I think this is actually the experience of most motorcyclists. I would wear one set of clothing for the commute. I'm 47. I want to keep riding for another four decades. And so what I wear very much is there to support that. So riding boots, either two-piece riding leathers, or riding jeans that are, double A rated, for slides and et cetera, and then a similar jacket. If the weather permits. If it's really cold, then I do have a one-piece suit from a manufacturer who's highly known for making those one-piece suits that has padding in it and is rain resistant. And I would usually wear the heated jacket underneath that. I would say the one-piece is probably my get up from November to maybe early March. And then I'll switch to whatever else will work in the weather. In the summer, it's riding jeans, and then I have a AA rated base layer that I'll just wear over a t-shirt because that gets me enough airflow. But what it's also meant is when I come to work, I have a wardrobe at work that I would then change into. And then when I'm going home, change out of, and then go, go back home.
So basically gear changing, storing, changing back. Yeah,
exactly. Yep. You got it.
All right. Has there ever been were there any situations where you had to arrive dressed up aside from work? Let's say some, I don't know, out of office situation where you have to find a way where to store your gear and, navigate through challenges like that?
For me, no challenge as far as the storage of the work, but even on my RS, I have two side bags. So if I am going to any sort of social get together where, again, I don't want to show up in leathers, what I would do is I just have a lot of wrinkle-free clothing. And I do have khakis that are riding rated as well. So I would show up in those and then change my shirt and dress shirt from what was stored in the bag and then put them on, which for me, is kind of the reality of motorcycling. But if better gear does come out, meaning for sort of, an undergarment or something, then I would at the very least explore that, because all of the riding chinos I have, for example, those are something I can wear with your product, plus they're still safe enough for slides and et cetera. Yep. And it limits how much I have to change when I show up somewhere.
Yeah. It's interesting. All right. How did you actually, so just jumping now to your story before the owning the Brummell motorcycle Blazer, and how did the whole story change afterwards? How did you discover Brummell, first of all? How did you hear about us?
Yeah, well, that came about through just frustration or the inconvenience of this entire routine, that I just described, that you and many others go through, which is just having to change all the time. And so I, for me, it wasn't social media or any of the advertisements. I just quite literally put into Google motorcycle suit jacket or motorcycle blazer, and your jacket came up. So I checked it out from there, read some of the reviews, and for me, again, being 47 and wanting to spend several more decades riding, it was both the looks, but as well as the safety rating that for me was the hook of, all right, this isn't, some thrown together product that looks good, but may not protect me as much in the slide because it doesn't have the ratings. Your product did have the ratings. And so that's what spurred me to give it a shot.
Yeah. What was the aspect when you received the product that surprised you the most? Was it the looks? Was it the, aside from, all the certifications being in place and the ratings, what impressed you the most? Let me express in that way.
Yeah. What impressed me so in selecting the products, even before I got it, like I said, it was the certification, but then the skins, right? So I don't have to buy different jackets for different looks. And not that I'm vain, but I also don't want to show up to, dozens of meetings in the same jacket also. Having different skins, right. With different colors, patterns, et cetera, was key. Not to mention if I am wearing, a different sort of a riding chino or even just normal slacks, I can use that to kind of match the color of the skin to those slacks, so it may look more like a suit. Because again, for me in my work, I really do end up needing that more. So having the switchability without having to buy an entire new jacket with the protective layer was really an appealing at user aspect for me, and then because I do like design, that also had its own appeal of, oh, this is neat, right? Like to be able to do this.
Right.
What I was happy with when I received the jacket was the quality of the skin. And I'm looking at it now. What I mean by the quality is truly the texture of the fabric, and then the color and richness of it. It looked to me very much like what I could walk into a suit store and just buy, you know, a good sports jacket or a suit, which not only would have that color, but the makeup of the fabric itself is just a really nice professional looking fabric.
Great to hear that. So the basically the appearance and the mm-hmm. well, how the fabric felt, right? The quality overall, and what was one of our priorities was that when you go into, you know, a meeting or an event, that no one actually knows that you're wearing mm-hmm. a protective jacket. And if we manage to achieve that, then you know, I'm happy to hear that. That it's a, you know, it looks like just a normal, elegant, classy suit. So it's, you know, it's an aspect that you can't see it on the pictures. I think it's a good that you get that once you receive the product. Now, just curious, how do you combine it? Because you mentioned you usually wear with khakis, like protective chino pants or stuff like that. Do you do it with like chinos or jeans maybe?
I have riding jeans, but I'm not a fan of wearing jeans at work. That probably dates me. So I have a number of, you know, just different colored riding chinos, whether it's sort of a khaki color or, you know, sage or white. I'll usually end up combining it with that. Sometimes I will put on, I have suits that are similar in color to some of the skins, like your navy and then the grayer color, especially in the summer, because those are they breathe better than riding chinos. I may put that on, so there's no protection there, but then still end up wearing the blazer. And then whatever, you know, whatever shirt goes with it, maybe a vest, bow tie, because I don't wear a tie, so anything like that.
Right. All right. Now, getting to the, well, difficult but interesting discussion. interesting part of the discussion, but a difficult one. You were in an accident, right? Mm-hmm. You got into a motorcycle accident wearing the Brummell motorcycle blazer. So how did that happen? And, you know, can you tell us a bit more about, you know, the whole situation and how you end up with, you know, after the accident, basically?
Sure. And then I'll touch on how what you noted about whether the jacket looks like it's an actual protective jacket or not. So I commuted to work. This was in the middle of December. Again, the Philly area, so it was fairly cold. I think it was actually like 24 or 25 at night, and then it was supposed to be a high 40s during the day. And I was going from my office on campus to another building on campus. Whenever I do that, I, of course, all the more end up wearing the jacket just so I end up arriving at the meeting looking professionally. In terms of how it happened basically me coming in and entering a large parking lot at what I think was a reasonable speed for that area, given whatever how fast everyone else is going, which was about 30 miles per hour, and I ended up just hitting some black ice in a corner, which is usually shaded. And it was silly in the sense that I'm usually aware of that just being colder. So I think this was probably a mixture of my fault as well as ride long enough, I guess, you know, I'll get in an accident. So anyway, hit the ice, ended up high siding, And unfortunately, as people tend to, when you high side, you put your arms out. And I was completely not aware that I was even putting my arm out. So anyway, ended up sliding. The motorcycle ended up sliding, which is how people knew that I ended up wiping out, because then everyone ran out from an adjacent building to offer me aid. So I broke my arm because I put my arm out. Now, with respect to the product itself, I had zero contusions anywhere, meaning no scratches, no slides, even though the knuckles of my glove, which is a protective, you know, regular riding glove, were definitely well scraped through. My helmet was scraped up enough in the back because I ended up putting my arm out, I think, and then rolling. And so sliding on my back for a good amount of time. I have an RI helmet because I love RI helmets, and that got scraped through enough on the back that I ended up needing to buy another helmet because this was no longer safe to use. The Brummell jacket in the back. So this is the skin, not the inside, because I removed the inside. So
that's just the outer layer. Basically, we're looking at the skin, right?
Yep, that's exactly it. Yeah. So this is just the again, my words, the cosmetic outer layer that, you know, I can change out. I mean, it must offer some protection, but it's not designed for it, right? So I ended up sliding on my back, and the back of the skin has two small tears in it and a number of scrapes. The button popped off. And otherwise, I have no damage on my back, no skin damage, nothing else. But the inside protective part of the jacket, the padding, you know, the sort of Kevlar, whatever protective lining, was in perfect shape. And when the emergency medical techs came and took the jacket off, because my arm was broken at an angle, so they're the ones who removed it. Nobody had any idea. Nobody had any idea that this was actually protective gear. They thought I was just wearing gloves and a helmet going for a motorcycle ride. And when they took it off and could see the inner liner, you know, and that there's padding and everything else in it, that's when people who also ride motorcycles, who I work around, they were really surprised by the fact that this was not me, you know, just throwing on some sports blazer and going for a ride on campus, but that this was an actual protective gear. And they were also impressed by how well it literally saved my skin.
Oh, that's, I'm really glad to hear that the product really helped you out stay safe. Just to recap for the audience, because I know that most people still mix things up with the product, since it's not straightforward when it comes to what is skin, what is the jacket, and what is so the Brummell Blazer is comprised of two pieces: the inner layer, which is the protective layer made out of DuPont Kevlar, has all the impact protectors on the elbows, on the shoulders, and on the back, CE level 2, and fully covered in DuPont Kevlar, so that provides you both protection in terms of impact and abrasion resistance, meaning if you slide on an asphalt or a rough surface, it won't break and you'll damage your skin. On top of that, you go get the Brummell skin, which is actually just a skin that looks like a normal classic blazer. So it's the Brummell skin and the protective layer. Those are the two main parts of the Brummell motorcycle blazer. Now, what you say actually is that you went in an accident. Through an ice, basically black ice. So you high sided around 30 miles per hour, and even though your helmet is deeply damaged in terms of sliding, so it misses a few layers, gloves as well, but on the areas that you slided with the Brummell Blazer, you basically suffered no injury in terms of the skin or the shoulder or the back, right? So the area that was supposed to be protected by the blazer was basically untouched. The jacket basically remained untouched, the protective layer, just the skin, which is a replaceable part that got actually two holes in it.
That's correct. I mean, I've never, I'm one of those folks who doesn't leave product reviews. And as I said, I reached out to you folks because I was so impressed. I mean, I ended up sliding several parking spot lengths, needed a new helmet. And when I got up, my human skin was completely fine. And it's the jacket outer layer, as you put it, which you folks call skin. That's the only thing that needed to be replaced. Right. Meanwhile, my helmet got banged up enough. And like I said, if I didn't end up breaking my arm, I still would have left the review. I would have just recovered faster. But it was very, very impressive from at least something that visually, because it's not like a track suit, right? You wipe out on track in a track suit, that's what track leathers do. I wouldn't leave a review because they did their job. I think I had the same expectation of this, but just the experience made me recognize really how fantastic of a job it had done.
That's great to hear. So you have a new skin now, right? You have the old one with you, mm-hmm. with the holes.
Yep.
Can I just see it one more time, like the damage?
Yeah, of course. Sure. So, here's the front of it. So this is the back where I ended up sliding, and again, the telemetry stuff in the bike's at about 30 miles per hour. So, there's two holes on the back.
Right.
Because I ended up probably just sliding a little bit more on my right side. Shoulder pad here is scraped through. And then I had it zipped up, both zippers, which of course is what also helps with the actual safety rating. The button, which does nothing for the safety rating, popped off. But that's the only damage, again, at 30 miles per hour, right? So to me, in fact, kind of unpacking it, the button probably popped off because the jacket outer layer was moving around. But again, the inner actual protective layer I had zipped up. And so that remained secure throughout the entire slide.
So it remained on your body the whole time. That's the important thing.
Absolutely.
Unfortunately, you ended up breaking your arm, right? Because you fall, you actually extend it and you land it up on the hand. Difficult thing to avoid, but it's it's just a natural instinct that goes when you fall. So I think it's quite a difficult situation actually to avoid, especially in a fall. Like you don't think about it in while falling. All right, that's really great to hear that you actually didn't suffer more damage because of the blazer, so it protected you. And maybe if you didn't fall on your arms, you wouldn't even break the arm. So you might have passed without. But what's done, it's done. That's the good thing is that you're recovered and you're almost back to riding shortly. So that's the most important thing. All right. Last but not least, would you recommend the Brummell Blazer to any of your friends or riding buddies basically out there?
Yeah, absolutely. And unequivocally, whether worn for a commute or, as I said, what was supposed to be for me, probably a 1.5 mile ride from one end of campus to the other, long or short commute, absolutely. It more than did its job.
That's great to hear. Last, thank you very much for taking the time to speak with us today. I enjoyed the discussion. I'm happy to learn that you're recovered once again. Thank you for sharing your experience with the product.
Yeah, thank you. I look forward to you guys creating more and different products.
Thanks, Les. Thank you. Appreciate that.
Sure.
So this was our first series of the Brummell video interviews. As I said, we're going to continue. This was the first interview that we had today, first episode. We are continuing this series with other writers. We're going to feature writers from different parts of the world, different people being part of the Brummell motorcycle. We are still thinking about the name. Should we call it like a classy club? We're still not sure about that. But actually, owners of Brummell Blazers, to learn about their habits, about their stories, and their rides, basically, in general. So this was the first episode. Last, thank you again for joining. I really enjoyed our discussion, and see you guys in the next video. Bye.